Well, hello, this is Data-Driven Formula One with Patrick Hansen, Ganna Pogrebna. Hi, Patrick.
Hello, Ganna. Hello, all.
And today we're talking, we finally got to women.
Right.
My dream has come true. We finally got to women in Formula One. And today we're going to talk about the most successful drive, female driver in the history of Formula One, Lella Lombardi.
Exactly. Exactly.
There were other women, but she's like, for the record, the most successful driver,
yes,
female driver in Formula One.
Exactly, up to today, which is a little bit sad, as she was her time was in the middle of the 1970s. Lella Lombardi, her nickname was the Tigress of Turin. It seems that this nickname she received from local press, and we may discuss why, because it may be a little bit lazy, because she was not from Turin, she was from Piemont, near Turin, but not from the city.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, it's also quite quite a nice sort of introduction to the episode that we are kind of always talking about with Patrick, but we haven't done yet on women in Formula One generally. And yeah, we had actually quite cool women in management and in engineering. But yeah, driver, well, as you all know, driving is not really something that that favors women even today.
Yeah.
And yeah, so it this is why the story of Lella Lombardi is really, really cool. And it would be good to have actually women in Formula One, like from my personal perspective. I know that some people will disagree with me, even if maybe not in the same events as men. Maybe there should be, I don't know, a separate league. But I guess maybe the sponsorships and the audience still do not see female events are survivable, to me it is strange. It is a strange pattern. But anyway, let's talk about Lella Lombardi and save the sort of this talk about feminism and women in Formula One for a different time.
Exactly, because this I just wanted to add. We will still do this special episode. But today we really focus on Lella, and I think we want to celebrate her as a person and not want to take away the space for her to discuss women in motorsports in general. We really should do this in a separate episode, and we will do this in a separate episode.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so here a short profile. Complete name, Maria Grazia Lombardi, also known as Lella Lombardi. She was a racing driver from Italy, as you may imagine from the name. She's born in Frugarlo in Piemont. She was the daughter of a local butcher, and here she supported the family business quite from early on. So it's not that easy to find information about her. Now there is, and we will come to this later, there's one documentary which you can even see for free on streaming. So so she was really involved in family business, as it's quite normal, I think, up to today, especially if you're not growing up in the big city in northern Italy. As a child, when possible, you try to start to help your parents. So she was at the end, as she was really into driving, into cars, trucks, whatever. She really at the end was enjoying driving the truck of her father.
That's right. And you know, like kind of character wise, she reminds me a little bit. I mean, I do apologize in advance to Italian fans who probably will not like the parallel, but she reminds me of Margaret Thatcher a lot because, you know, in this, well, it's, I will explain why, because in, as you know, Margaret Thatcher was the daughter of a grocer, right? And so Lella Lombardi is the daughter of a butcher, and you know, succeeded in a completely different field, right? And but you know, you need to have very, very strong character. And also, like we mentioned with Patrick in other episodes, Lella Lombardi was kind of not only Formula, like driving in Formula One events, but in many other events, notable sports and car events. And you're all probably wondering what it means to be the most successful woman in Formula One. Does it mean that she won a GP? Does it mean that she won a championship? But actually, well, she qualified for a race and she got half a point. So that's basically as far as women get in Formula One. But nevertheless, she was driving for three teams, March, Ram and Williams. And she was incredibly talented driver and was successful in sports car racing in general. I mean, it's just in Formula One. I mean, this is what we've got. But she had a really, I mean, despite you know, the fact that she looks, I mean, if you watch us on YouTube, she looks very friendly and smiling in the photo. Yeah, she really had a very sort of, she was kind of the iron lady of the of the racing driving, because you know, you had to survive in that environment and pursue your dream of driving and also attract sponsorships who would support you, and she had all that, and she wasn't even, you know, the daughter of mechanic or, you know, the daughter of like an automotive tycoon. She was, you know, from kind of middle class family.
Exactly. Surprised that to compare with Margaret Thatcher, etc. In general, I mean, if I understand her life and career, I mean, for me, she's not that much different than, for example, Vittorio Brambilla, about whom we spoke the last time. I mean, they both came from Italian middle class. Vittorio, son of mechanic, Lella, daughter of a butcher. So they had been in involved in the family business. They've been working, let's say, they not had a higher educational background, but they both had been racers. They've been living for racing, and with racing, I mean, being around the car, working at the car, driving the car, less speaking with the press, less about marketing. Both had soft skills, as Vittorio had a very good personal relationship with the owner of Beta Tools, and Lella Lombardi had also a very good relation to the owner of Lavazza, the Italian Espresso. That's why what you mentioned, she was able, thanks to her soft skills, to bring an important sponsor to the team.
Yeah, that's right. But I mean, it's not only soft, it's also, like I said, people may disagree. So I just wanted to make a parallel with another kind of strong female character. So to me, there is a parallel. Maybe other people will not see it, which is perfectly fine. But in any case, let's just continue maybe talking about her.
Just to be clear, I'm not saying that I don't see it. It surprised me, as I would have not seen it before. But I would agree with you. And of course, she was not only had the soft skills, but she also had the hard skills. So she was a talented driver,
yeah,
which
so she's,
she improved.
Yeah, and she started in karting. I mean, this is also so if we, there were actually women drivers, obviously prior to Lella Lombardi, but many of them started, in cars, like in sort of more traditional, maybe most kind of sports events, especially in kind of at the beginning of 20th century, there were like women who liked speed, were quite successful in various events. But so karting career is not really typical. And so she had like kind of like a male career in a sense, because karting is something that was quite characteristic of folks in 1960s, 1970s, and normally there were men.
Exactly.
So, mm-hmm.
And she did the normal path, how to enter in Formula One, going through the slower, the smaller leagues. So she won the Italian Formula One 850 championship in 1970. She won the 1971. She moved to the UK to follow her dream. So she won the 71 British Formula Ford Mexico Championship. Before this, in 1968, she participated at the Italian Formula 3 Championship, where she ended up on the second position. She really proved that she.
She can drive. Women can drive.
Yes. If you want to resume it, women can drive, and she really proved it. So she's not came in because some team looked for a female driver to get more sponsorship or whatever. So she really has been a driver, and for this, I think she was not that different than somebody as Brambilla, for example. Mm-hmm. So she was a real racer.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Absolutely. And she was really successful, as you can see, in other championships and in various sports events. And these were not female events. These were mixed events, where she was often the only woman.
mostly.
Yeah, mostly the only woman. So yeah, I mean, this is also important to understand. So because I think these days in these various events we normally compare men to men and women to women, but it's very rare when you can actually compare a kind of female talent to, say, the general pool, right? And if the general pool is male dominated. So in this case, we saw that she was not only winning races, she was winning big championships, she was really extraordinary driver, and it's only fitted that she, in the end, got her chance to compete in Formula One.
Yeah, and another point, I would assume, as it was told by another female driver, if you're competing as a woman in a male-dominated series, normally, and I assume even more in the 1970s, difficult to accept for a male driver to get beaten by a woman, because it was, let's say, widely in society, the idea that women cannot drive, or at least not drive on the level of male drivers. So we saw that sometimes male drivers even have been driving more aggressively against a female driver to avoid to get overtaken by a female driver, which you may imagine the comments you would get from friends and family at that time if this happens.
Well, let's just, well, I wouldn't, Patrick is very politically correct, you see, because he works in compliance, that's why. But I wouldn't use the word wars. I mean, it's not wars, it's ease. Still ease. I mean, how many women drivers do we currently have in Formula One? Zero. So in a sense, in that sense, probably 1970s was a better time for female driving, even, you know, when, even though it required extraordinary characters like Lella Lombardi, but, you know, currently the situation didn't change much, and it didn't change much probably because the sponsors are not there for women, probably because the opportunities are not there. And you know, all these other things that should be there but are not there, and perceptions also probably have not caught up since 1970s.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And but thanks to her skills and her attitude, she made it into 1974. Into Formula One in 1974. She debuted in 74 with a privately entered Brabham, supported by the Italian Automobile Club, but failed to qualify. And as mentioned before, she had the soft skills. She could, she was able to network. And due to this, she got the support first by the Italian Automobile Club, who brought her into Formula One, even if she could not qualify. And please consider a privately entered Brabham. So there's a high possibility that also any other kind of driver would not have qualified with this car.
Yeah, but I mean, it also, I think, a very characteristic that she was driving Brabham car, because again, coming from the karting experience, this was probably very natural. When we talk about Jack Brabham, we discussed how he also came from kind of karting, him and Bruce McLaren, you know, so they were very, very active in karting, and even first cars that they produced, they kind of looked like karting cars a little bit. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so this was probably also not only affordable car, but also the car where she felt more sort of confident, right? And so this is quite characteristic of again of her career and the opportunities that she took. And it's always kind of, you know, taking risk with understanding of your ability and what you can achieve. So I think it's very characteristic of Lella Lombardi in general, and it's really cool that she has chosen Brabham car, even though like she didn't qualify, but she qualified in March eventually. But yeah,
right. So the year after she joined the March team, there was the number one driver with Vittorio Brambilla, and I think at the end of the season also a German driver, Hans-Joachim Stuck, joined the team. So a factory team, but a very small team. To be honest, a car which was quite fast, but very, very unreliable. Yeah, and I think we will discuss this. We'll come back to this when we see the results from the 1970 season. So she really became the first person to qualify again for a race since 1958, since also Italian Maria Teresa De Filippis.
Yeah, so the first female driver, obviously there were guys qualifying and winning, but yeah, in terms of, it was a female.
Of course, a female, And also 75 was her best year in Formula One, where she surprisingly
half a point
Again, 1975, sorry, again, we mentioned it also in our last special episode. 1975 was really a very special year, which was not only said so by Niki Lauda, but really a lot of happened, surprising victories, tragedies, so very interesting year. So if you not listen to our episode, we strongly recommend to do so. So she won the half point at the Spanish Grand Prix. You may said that she scored especially at this race because there had been a lot of trouble around the drivers boycotted it because of the Spanish government at that time. There had been a fatal accident. Why is the reason why the race was stopped earlier, and this is the reason why she not got 1 point as you get normally for the sixth position, but as it was only around half of the race time, she only received half a point, but nevertheless this half point is still the best result for a female driver up to today.
Yeah, so probably at this point the people who are watching this episode or listening to us are wondering, well, what are they talking about? She only got half a point. Well, you know, you have to understand that this is not just half a point. That's a historical half a point because to date, this is the best result yes. from a female driver in Formula One. And kind of highlights the kind of the lack of opportunities for women, but also highlights the fact that women can score points in Formula One and are capable of driving these cars. So, yeah,
exactly. And I mean, only half a point. I mean, most of the drivers never scored half a point. A lot of Formula One drivers never got a sixth position. Many, many never even got the opportunity to enter Formula One. So even if it's half, only half a point, it's really an achievement.
It is.
Especially when you're not entering Formula One, if you don't have the rich family background. So it's really something which is only based on your personal abilities and skills. Okay, so this is a little bit more background on that particular race. As I said, tragically, we had an accident where the car from the embassy, Graham Hill team, driven by Rolf Dommelin, Rolf Dommelin, maybe another driver, relatively underrated. He was leading the race, not his fault, but the car had a problem and the rear wing, he lost his rear wing, and due to this, he lost the control and killed four people. I think one photographer, one marshal, or two marshals and one spectator. And this was the reason why the race was stopped around in the little bit more than half of the time. So this was her best race. Nevertheless, also she had other good results that year. For example, she had been seventh at the Nürburgring race. As we always underline, Nürburgring, one of the most difficult racetrack where you come to as a Formula One driver. So really, this also underlined she really had the skills to be in Formula One, and maybe she would have deserved more points. But you know, this was at the end. This was her only points she received.
She also tried to do the American race, and she qualified but couldn't actually race because of the car problem.
Yeah,
So again, you know, just highlighting that she was her the ability was there. And the car wasn't there for her, but you know, the ability was definitely there.
Exactly. In 76, she stayed at March together with Vittorio Bambilla and Hans-Joachim Stuck. She started at the first Grand Prix in Belgium. She finished 14th, so for the small team, and considering that she maybe was only the second or third driver, I think a quite good result. Unfortunately for her, Ronnie Peterson became available as he broke away from Lotus, and Peterson was and one of the.
They hired him,
and you cannot blame them to do so, because I think he was one of the most talented drivers that year. And if you have the opportunity to get him, then you should try to. And the only problem maybe for her was that March replaced her with him, and they not replaced, let's say, Bambilla and Stuck to get a car for Ronnie Peterson.
Well, that's why I think we can blame him. Yeah, we can blame them for this decision. Because, yeah, it's not clear how they kind of made that decision. I mean, maybe Bambilla, okay. He might have been, you know, the top driver they had, but yeah. I mean, we don't know how the choice was made.
Yes, also you don't know how are the contracts. For example, Bambilla, you remember, he always drove a car completely looking different than the others, because he had the personal sponsor, and I think his seat was directly paid by Beta Tools, so they could not take the car away from him, because there's a contract, there's the money, and maybe the money that Leila was bringing in was less. So we don't know how the contracts have been. But of course, somehow you may blame them, maybe not to try to have four cars or whatever. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so she tried to stay in Formula One. Well, she stayed in Formula One first with Ram and later with Williams. But let's say her big time had been 75 and has been with the March team.
But also, I just want to mention that, this is a good slide, yeah, to say what I want to say, because we also have to give it to the teams, to March and to Williams, to Ram, for giving her a chance, because they could have said, you know, we don't want any women, but they said, you know, like, yeah, you can bring sponsorship, you drive well, okay, here's your chance, which is also, you know, quite a revolutionary decision for these teams. Considering the time when the decisions were made.
Well, I mean, it would be revolutionary also today in 2021, as there's no female driver.
Yeah, maybe I mean,
Not even one near to the
today. Today, all the teams chicken out. Back in the day, there were teams who were like, you know, we're gonna have a woman driving. Yeah. For us, so now we have all this all these teams with lots of money and no women.
Exactly. To bring a little bit data here to the episode, we see a comparison of her against her colleagues in the 1975 season. So we see here the qualification and the race results. So she started in Spain, the famous Spain race where she got her half a point. Vittorio won a position better, so he came in as fifth. And you see a lot of retired, same with Vittorio, which shows that what we already discussed, the March was a fast car if it was working, but a lot of times it wasn't working, which makes it difficult, especially if you're coming new to Formula One, to get experience and to develop yourself. Nevertheless, as said, she had a seventh position in Germany, an eighth position in the US.
And sixth position and sixth position in Spain as well.
Yeah, I mean, this was the famous race where she got
the half point, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, if you see the qualification, she was considerably slower than Vittorio Brambilla.
Mm-hmm.
But here you have Brambilla, sorry, this is miswritten.
Typo.
That's why I was stuck.
You guys know whom we mean, and if you don't know, yes, we have a separate episode on Brambilla brothers, so it should be Vittorio Brambilla. Mm-hmm.
So ignore what you see, it's Vittorio Brambilla, and please consider two things here. First of all, Vittorio was a very fast driver, so very difficult to beat him. He was very talented, very fast. Second, Lella Lombardi was complaining a lot that there was a technical problem with her car, that the chassis was not working fine, and that something was broken, not was straight as it should be. Unfortunately, the March team ignored her, as also then, for example, they not asked Vittorio to test her car because Vittorio was practically already 73 years old and he was not much of a team player, maybe. So he was doing his thing, Lela was doing her thing. Why I'm mentioning this, the next season is when Ronnie Peterson took over Lela's car. Ronnie complained that there was a technical problem with the car and it was not really drivable as it should be. And only as Ronnie said this, they really buzzed to really look into technically, and they really found out that this was true. And this may explain also a little bit why Lela was in the race and qualifying, why she didn't have the same speed as Vittorio, or at least why she not was closer to him.
Mm-hmm.
So,
sports cars.
Sports cars. And the same as with many other drivers, she was really a racer, so she was there. Her life was racing, so even if she didn't got a seat anymore in Formula One, she stayed active in other series, for example, in endurance races. She also started at NASCAR.
She won in Braguso. She won the six-hour race, which is... again, I don't know, maybe that's also the best female result in endurance racing.
I would assume yes. You're of course right on this. So she really started in a lot of different seasons. And as if I'm correct, she also started 1 year in the German touring car series. So she really stayed active. And even after she retired from driving herself in 88, she founded her own racing team, Lombardi Autosport. Mm-hmm. Well, quite sadly, she survived motorsports, but died already in young age with 50, only 50 years. Due to cancer in Milan, and she's buried in her hometown of Frugallo, and she was commemorated by her spouse, who from from whom I don't have much information, because in opposite to other drivers, let's say somebody like Jochen Rindt, or then she never looked to be much in the press, so there's not much known about her personal life, to be honest.
Yeah, and I have to say that I was trying to find this the picture of this bust in her in Frugarolo, and yeah, I couldn't find it. So if you guys have the photo or know the yes. link where one could go yes. and have a look at it, please leave a comment underneath this video and or somehow kind of leave a link as a comment to the podcast. Yeah. So basically, yeah.
I think you can see the bust in the documentary, which we will mention later on.
Oh, okay, brilliant. So yeah, if there is a photo somewhere, that'd be cool, because I was searching for it. I couldn't find it.
Right, the same photo I couldn't find either, but if I remember, it is shown in the documentary. Mm-hmm. As I said, she wasn't really a person being much in the press. So if getting asked, she answered to the reporters, the journalists, even, and you see this also in the documentary, the questions had been sometimes quite stupid, but nevertheless, she answered it. For example, and you see this in the video, the journalist asked her if, as a woman, she's not too weak to drive a Formula One car. And as you mentioned in the beginning, she was a very friendly character, so she friendly answered, I don't have to carry it, I just have to drive it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this is a very weird question, because in principle, if you are lighter, you are better off in the sports car in general, and Formula One car in particular. You want to be lighter. So in that regard, it's even more weird that we don't have female drivers in Formula One, because they are lighter and they would go faster.
Exactly. Yes, and there's an engine in the car, so there's no problem.
Yeah, there is no problem indeed. I mean, yeah, it's, but oh well.
Yeah.
We cannot help it. We cannot help these questions.
No. So this is also, unfortunately, the only quote we have today. Nevertheless, we speak a little bit about the legacy, and as we already discussed, she's up to today the most successful female drivers, at least if we focus on monoposto racing. I mean, in general, maybe the most successful drivers would be Michel Mouton, who really was very, very successful, but this was in rally sport. So if you're speaking about endurance races, about formula racing, up to today, she's the most successful racing driver.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And even, you know, in comparison with other women in Formula One, I mean, this, like we said, this half a point goes a long way. I mean, look at us. We are this half a point was earned in the 1970s, and today is 2021.
Yeah.
Just, and no one has done better in terms of, you know, women racers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. She founded her own team, the Lella Lombardi Autosport. The website is still active, but I would assume it. The team does not exist anymore. We can put the link, and we will do this, they put the link here in the show notes. The website looks like it was programmed like 20 years ago and not updated since then. But nevertheless, from an historic point of view, it's still online, so you still can see the website.
Yeah, it looks like a website from 1990s, but then, you know, Some websites do look like that, so it's okay.
Yeah, it seems that after her death, the team disappeared, and since then also the website was not updated anymore. But at least somebody is still paying and it's still online.
Yeah, it's still online.
As mentioned, there's one documentary. You can see it for free on a service which is called Tubi. You can look it, and we put the link in the show notes. You can do it from your computer and maybe also from your smart TV if you have Tubi there. I'm not quite sure if they show it worldwide, but here in the US, you can stream it for free. And this shows a little bit Lella, her life, her career, how she started, it motivates her. But also it has, it aligns to today to discuss today's female drivers and to discuss what is needed to have again a female driver in Formula One. So if you have Tubi, it's called Beyond Driven, and hopefully you can find it here.
That's right. Well, I haven't watched yet this documentary, so I'm definitely going to do it.
Yeah.
Even though, well, I kind of saw several things that kind of were combined information about several women where Lombardi was present, but definitely not not this one. So looking forward to watching it.
Yeah. And last but not least, you may have, at least if you have a female daughter, that's of course a little bit stupid. I meant if you have a daughter, because they're always female normally, you may, and she was up to 10 years. The last time, you know, maybe the Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls, which was, and it still is, a very successful collection of inspiring stories from females all over the world. They are short stories, one page, which you can read, for example, as a good night story to your daughter. A real bestseller. There have been two books and various merchandising. And one of the stories is also about Lella Lombardi. I have the book here, so I can show it to you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say that, Patrick, that you actually were factually correct about female daughter, because gender, technically speaking, is non-binary. So, you know, if currently we have all sorts of people living believing that they are maybe non-binary, so in this case, you know, I think there is no mistake there. But coming back to the book,
that's
a great book.
That's correct. But let's say if you're non-binary, you may not consider that you are a son or a daughter.
But that's true, but not necessarily true, right? So we don't know.
Exactly. Anyway, if you have a daughter, also, to be honest, the stories would be nice to read to boys, but nevertheless, the book is called Good Night Stories for Rebel Girls. And there's I think in this first edition, there's also a story about a transgender child. So it is also included in these books. Anyway. Yeah,
basically, this book is about the fact that, well-behaved women never make history, including Lella Lombardi.
not directly. I mean, Lella Lombardi, we discussed it. She was very well-behaved, but
she wasn't. If she was well-behaved, she would be helping her dad in a butcher shop, but she wasn't well behaved. That's why she was racing.
we don't have that much information, unfortunately, about her life, but I let's say I didn't saw.
I'm just joking. I'm just saying that like it depends on the definition of well behaved, but.
But let's say it's about inspiring stories which are, let's say, untypical, for women, unfortunately. But let's say I think this has changed a little bit. So I mean, so today I think it's nothing strange, let's say, for a girl to be interested in STEM topics.
Yes.
Okay. So what I've showed. Going shortly back to the book, so woman, there's like one page of story, so quite good for girls 6 to 10 years. Also, there's always a nice picture. It starts as, let's say, a good night story should start, just to read you the beginning. Once there was a girl who liked to help her father deliver meats in the van. So you see, she was well behaved. She helped her father. Every time they had a delivery, she would jump into the driver's seat and her father would time her. So her father luckily supported her, as far as we learned from the story. Her name was Maria Gracia, but everybody called her Lella. So if you have a daughter, let's say 6 to 10 years, I really would recommend these books for her. And let's say this
brilliant.
Is a way as many may have rediscovered Lella, because I think, to be honest, she was a little bit forgotten
as
a driver today.
Well, not as forgotten as other women, but okay, yes. Other women are even less known. I think Lella Lombardi is the name that probably some people heard, I would have thought.
Yes, but let's say this book has sold millions of times. It's not only that, let's say, the girls get to know her, to hear her name, but also the fathers who are reading this to their daughters.
Hopefully, fingers crossed.
Yep.
We will do a separate episode on female drivers, but this is a good list.
Exactly. So this is, as I said, we will do a separate episode, but let's say this is a list which is a little bit sad. I mean, you have to remember the first driver ever was a woman, the wife of Gottlieb Daimler, because for whatever, I mean, you know, Gottlieb Daimler invented the automobile, but for whatever reason, he not wanted to drive it.
Like himself, and said, you drive.
Exactly. he didn't, if I remember it right, he not asked wife, but his wife said, if you don't drive it, I will drive it, and the world will see what an important invention you made. So really the very first driver was a woman. So with this in mind, it's quite sad today we don't have, let's say, any female Formula One driver, and maybe not even one candidate for the next 2 years. And maybe in the beginning, this even were, there had been more. I mean, we had Hélène Issé, who was quite well known at the end of the 1920s. We had Maria Teresa De Filippis in the 50s. We had Lella Lombardi. We even had a second one in the 76 season with Divina Galicia. And after this, we still had Desi Wilson, 1980, and the last one who tried to qualify was Giovanna Amati in 1992. And also she was driving for Brabham. But as far as I remember, at that time, Brabham was, at least with the second car, not possible to even qualify for the race. So independent, male, female, whatever, the car was not really competitive in 1992.
Yeah, that's right. But I mean, you know, this is also not a long list of women. And yeah, this is sad. But we will talk about it some other time because that deserves a separate, yeah, that deserves a separate consideration and analysis.
Yeah, that's right.
All right. With that, we will leave you with, you know, Lella Lombardi and her her life, career, and legacy. And yeah, as usual, just to remind you that our main platform is YouTube. If you're watching us on YouTube, please leave your comments, anything that we might have left out, let us know. And naturally, also, please leave some comments if you're listening to us on any of the other platforms where we are present. Thanks a lot.
Exactly. And if you're interested, please see the show notes where we have the links to the book and to the documentary.
That's right. And we will see you next time. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Bye.